Okay, so the next talk is going to be given by Leyla, Norooz, from here, University of Maryland, and this paper also received an honorable mention award.
Oh man, I've been really tired lately. It's like really hard work.
You're having good food, right?
Oh yeah, food's great. Oh, hey, Leyla, how's your play?
Not bad. I got a little sick on the way here, but I'm okay. Yeah.
Your heart is beating really fast. Are you okay?
Oh yeah, I'm about to do a pie talk. I'm really excited about it, so it's like, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Awesome. Good luck.
Yeah, good luck.
See you guys around.
See you.
Bye.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Leyla Norooz. I'm from the University of Maryland, and today I'm going to be talking about BodyVis, our new approach to body learning. Body learning through wearable sensing and visualization. So, unlike external body parts that are really easy to see and feel, internal body parts and organs are difficult for children to understand because they're hidden under layers of tissue and skin. Traditionally, kids have a lot of misconceptions about their body. So for example, they believe their heart is shaped sometimes in this playing card heart shape, when in reality, it looks something like this. They see their stomach moving in and out and believe that it's a breathing mechanism because they see that movement, but in reality, it's your lungs and your diaphragm that are helping you to breathe. And finally, kids have a lot of misconceptions about how food is digested in their bodies, what happens when they eat that food, and how waste is eliminated from their bodies. So traditionally, teachers use 3D models and games, coloring books, and activity books to teach these concepts to kids, but none of these are really responsive to the human body. So our approach has been to use on-body sensors and visualizations like this to show kids how their bodies work. So I'm gonna go through the talk that I'll be talking about today. We started a little bit on ideating how we wanted to build this shirt, going through sketching and prototyping, refining those prototypes to build 3 prototypes of BodyVis. I'll talk a little about the evaluations that we did for these prototypes, and finally, some future work that we're looking into right now. So we'll start with the ideation. We iteratively arrived at several design goals throughout this process, but I'm going to be talking about just 3 of them, and I'll refer you to our paper for the rest. So we wanted to make sure that we had this link between action and representation. So we wanted to provide immediate feedback to bodily actions and movements in the physical world. We wanted the shirts to be robust and lightweight enough so that it would allow for kids to move about the world, explore, and encourage them to really walk around and self-experiment. And finally, we wanted it to provoke curiosity and engagement. We wanted the data to be personally relevant to children. There we go. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the iterative process we went through to build these prototypes. We were inspired by Lamingo's work on wearable sensing and visualization to illustrate pollution in the air. So here, this is called warning signs, and in this project they've used on-body sensors to find CO2 levels in the air and show those levels on a heart on a shirt. So we started off by conducting a participatory design session to build the first prototype. We took the lessons that we learned from that first prototype to build our second prototype, held a second participatory design session, and had some informal evaluations before moving on to build the third prototype. So I'm going to go into detail a little bit about the first participatory design session we had. So the goals for this session were really to kind of explore the potential design options for building a shirt like this, and to get a little bit of insight into how kids really understand about their bodies. So in this session, the method that we used was cooperative inquiry. So this is just collaboration between adults and children to brainstorm and design and build new technologies for kids with kids. So in this session, we asked the kids to show us, or rather the team to show us, how they wanted to see their bodies illustrated on a shirt if they were to build something like this. And we found through their design several patterns emerging. So we saw that they wanted to use color to represent organ functionality. They wanted to see how things were moving throughout the body, using sound in a playful manner, and they wanted to use light to represent different types of actions in the human body. Okay, so we built the first prototype after our participatory design session and doing some brainstorming with our teams. And we started off by cutting out these felt pieces into anatomically correct shapes, sewing them together, stuffing it with pillow stuffing to get kind of this plush feeling to it, hand dyeing some of the organs to represent organ functionality using their colors. We embedded several LEDs inside the heart, and these LEDs are controlled through a pulse sensor that the user wears on their finger, so these lights actually pulsate on and off. And we also put electroluminescent wire on the lungs, so these also pulsate on and off to the user's heart rate. So when you actually turn it on, the visualization in the heart and lungs looks something like this. So this is someone's actual heart rate. And we've also got some digestive organs on this first prototype as well. We learned a lot of lessons building this first prototype, and we used those to build our second prototype. We saw that the sensor that we were using wasn't as reliable as we wanted it to be. The EO wire was really difficult to see in the daylight. We had a lot of positional compromises with building the organs, and the heavy organs limited the movement of children, so it was really hard for them to move around because they were weighing down. So from there we built the second prototype. So in the first prototype we were really looking to use those color, light, sound, and movement to build that first prototype. And we did the same thing in the second prototype, but we were looking more update the visual design, the wearer comfort, and kind of add some more animation approaches. So I'm not going to go into too much detail about the second prototype because there's not a lot of time, but I'll refer you to the paper for the details on that. So we did a second participatory design session and some informal evaluations next. And the goal for this participatory design session was to get feedback on the first and second prototypes we built and so co-design some improvements to the prototypes that we have. So here we kind of let the team explore with the shirts, play around with it, and get a feel for what they are, how they work, and just to get a little feedback about how they felt about these two prototypes. And we saw that where the first prototype promoted a lot of physical activity and experimentation, there was a lot of laughter, like silliness going on. In the second prototype, there was less activity, but there was a lot of interest in animations, in the organs, and how the shirt was actually built. So again, in our co-design session, we saw that the patterns emerged in sound representing organ functionality, seeing how things move throughout the body, and now we wanted to see some stomach animation, details on the stomach animation as well. So we did an informal evaluation at our local mini maker fair, and we took both of the shirts and let the students, parents, and teachers just kind of explore and just give us a little bit of feedback about how they felt about the shirt. And from there, we went on to build the third prototype, which is the current one I'm wearing right now. So I'm going to talk about how this works first before I give any details. So I'm actually wearing a Zephyr bioharness right now. So this picks up the user's heart and breathing rate data. So this is live data that you're seeing. So the data, don't judge me. the data is sent then to the phone in the stomach, so there's the phone is there, it has a purpose, and I'll explain that in a minute. And that data is sent to an Arduino Uno that's built into the shirt. So this controls the visualizations in the heart, and actually all the LEDs in the shirt. And all the hardware is tucked in a pouch inside of the shirt, so it's hidden from the user. So it's right here. And so we started off cutting out fabric this time instead of felt into anatomically correct shapes and embedding LEDs in between, sandwiching them together to build these organs. This time we had several detachable organs as well. So the way we do this is through magnets that are circled in yellow up there, and the heart, lungs, and liver and part of the stomach are all detachable. So when the user detaches one of the organs, the lights automatically stop working. And similarly, when you put, so here's a live example of it. So the lights stop working, and if you put the organs back onto the shirt, they automatically start working again. And if you actually put the organs on the wrong part of the shirt, then they don't work. So we've also added these outlines to help the kids know where to put the organs back on, and these colored highlighters to represent the organ that's supposed to be attached to it. So the pink there is for the lungs that are supposed to be attached. The heart and breathing rate, or rather the heart and lung visualizations are all live to the user. So again, this is live. And this is an example of someone with a much lower heart rate and breathing rate than me right now. So we also have a digestive system visualization. So it's the snack time visualization, or the digestive system, is triggered when the user presses the snack time button. So a little light turns on to indicate food traveling down through the user's body. The liver, pancreas, and gallbladder all turn on to show that they're functioning throughout this process. There's a little video that plays inside of the stomach showing how food is being broken down, and the stomach walls are churning it, and the acid is kind of breaking it down and speeding this up a bit because it takes a while. Food travels through, the swell and large, and sadness. The kids love it. So we went to do some evaluations. We had two evaluations. Our first study was teacher interviews, and the second was design deployment. So I'll start with our teacher interviews. So we had seven first through fourth grade elementary school teachers teaching science, and there were about half and half private and public school. We analyzed our data through pursuing an iterative coding scheme with a mixture of both deductive and inductive codes. And our interviews consisted of two parts. So the first was just to get some feedback on teaching approaches to body learning that the teachers currently have right now. And the second was to solicit some feedback on the first and third prototypes, so just to see how they felt about it. I'm not going to go into detail again about these teaching approaches. So I'll refer you to the paper to that, but just to go over it briefly, we learned a little bit about resources and materials that the teachers currently use to teach these concepts, how they engage children in these concepts, and what are current body learning challenges they have in the classroom with the kids. For the design probe, we saw that there was a lot of positive feedback about BodyVis's ability to engage children. So here we see one of the teachers saying something like this would definitely get them interested and motivated to learn about their bodies. We also saw the link between the user's physiology and movement to the visualization was key to learner engagement. So this teacher was saying that the link between what's actually happening in your body and what's being shown is really fantastic. So we asked teachers to show us kind of the activities that they would use BodyVis for. So we saw them giving examples of physical activities, peer collaboration activities, and just using BodyVis as a low-tech anatomical model. There were some concerns that the teachers had with using BodyVis. The most common one was the robustness and maintenance of the shirt. So this teacher said, if one of the sensors stops working, how do we replace it? We also saw concerns with cost, the potential of the shirt to distract the kids because it's so flashy. And finally, the misrepresenting different types of organs. And we also got a little bit of suggestions on how to improve the shirt, and mainly this was adding details to organs, so showing how different foods result in different things happening in your body, giving more control to the teachers, and providing more multi-sensory feedback. So for the design deployments, we went to three different deployment sites, and these were Boys and Girls Clubs in Maryland. We had participants ranging from ages 6 to 12, 12 boys, 18 girls, and totaling about 30 participants. After reviewing session data to develop an initial code book, we analyzed the physical actions with video audio data, and we also used open coding to analyze the different types of questions that the kids were asking as well. So we had about 90 minutes per session. We started off with an introduction and pre-questionnaire, a little BodyVis overview, an interactive trial for the kids to do different things with the shirts through tasks, a post-study questionnaire, and finally a pre-play session where they just played around with the shirts. So let's look at some of their overall reactions.
Cool.
So we also saw that the wearers and non-wearers were working together, to explore, play, and interact with BodyVis as well. So let's see that. Allowed children to kind of explore and resulted in a lot of unexpected inquiry and play that we'll see here.
Take it off. Oh my god. Take off his
Yeah, so we also saw that the fact that you can't can remove the organs, allow the children to explore the different layered nature of their body. So the kids would sometimes take it off, and this was two different sites. They would put it on their own bodies and see what would happen. So here's some examples of the common questions and observations that we saw.
Kids are talking
about
Did you put that? Humpback. Is that shirt connected to the leg?
And finally, we saw this concept of the disembodied BodyVis. So at the very end, we would put the mannequin, or we would put the shirt on a mannequin during the free play session. But we saw that the kids would still interact with the shirt. Sometimes they'd put on the bioharness, and even though they weren't wearing it, they'd still have these interesting interactions with the shirt. So moving on to the future. With every model of BodyVis, or with any model of the human body, we do realize that there are trade-offs with how we represent the body. So in the first prototype, we saw that the visualization in the lungs were representing blood flow, whereas in the third prototype, they represent airflow. So we're really interested in exploring these different types of representations of the same organs. We'd like to expand to other parts of the body, so for example, building a hat that shows kids how their brains work, so what lobes of the brain are being activated. And finally, we're really interested in health literacy for children, so taking this to a doctor's office, seeing how kids can learn about their bodies at the doctor's, or even making scrubs with BodyVis on it. So, summary, our work contributes to the field of wearables and tangibles for learning, and today we've been talking about BodyVis. Thank you so much for coming and listening.